Republic of Singapore is a small island city state off the southern tip of Malaysia. Yet despite its small size, it is the fourth most important financial center in the world and operates one of the top two busiest container ports in the world. With a population of only 5.5 million, Singapore is the second smallest country in ASEAN after Brunei in terms of population, but the smallest in terms of size. Yet, it ranks as one of the top 5 richest nations in the world in terms of GDP per capita. Historically, the first mention of the island comes from the time of Sivijaya Empire, when a small settlement called Temasek, or Sea Town, was an outpost of the empire. The island did not become prominent again until the nation we now know as Singapore was established in 1819 as a trading post of East India Company. After it was occupied by the Japanese in the Second World War, Singapore gained independence from the United Kingdom in 1963, and in 1965, after being expelled from Malaysia, became the state it is today. Singapore was a founding member of ASEAN, and under the rule of a single party since 1959, the country underwent rapid economic growth. Singapore has also been rated one of the least corrupt countries in the world. Unlike other nations in ASEAN, Singapore's population is predominantly Chinese, with large Malay and Indian communities as well. Most Singaporeans speak English, which is the main language used in commerce, although lately more and more students are learning Mandarin as a second or third language. As an island nation, Singapore has increased its territory through land reclamation activities, adding 120 square kilometers of land area, with an additional 100 square kilometers expected by 2030. Not all this land is meant for urban development. The country has set aside nearly 10% of its land for parks and nature reserves, giving the country a lush, green, and peaceful atmosphere. Singapore is home to several international organizations and offices related to ASEAN. So while we were there, we met with Dr. Termsak Chalom Palanupap, the lead researcher, political and security affairs at the Institute of Southeast Asia Studies, and asked him about the various activities of ASEAN.
We have a center here called ASEAN Study Center. We specialize on studying ASEAN as an organization. This is good for ASEAN because we need a quieter moment to concentrate on what ASEAN is doing. And what we are doing can be described as community building. Why we have ASEAN, why we build a community. I try to give you information to help you better understand ASEAN. 8th of August is the ASEAN Day. 8th August happened to be the date when the five founders of ASEAN met in Bangkok and then issued their ASEAN Declaration. 7 C's in ASEAN. First one, community building. Second one, the ASEAN Charter. This one. Third one is the concept of centrality, how ASEAN is positioning itself as a center for dialogue and cooperation in Southeast Asia and even in Asia Pacific. Commitment to create common ASEAN platform by the year 2022. Chairmanship of ASEAN, and lastly China and South China Sea. Back in history, 5 ASEAN founding members came together in Bangkok. And then now Brunei joined 84 after independence from the British. Vietnam 95, Laos and Myanmar 97, Cambodia 99. And now East Timor applied 2011, and in ASEAN we are considering the application. Community in ASEAN, we have 3 community pillars. The mass media in Thailand tend to focus on AEC, Economic Community. But you should know that ASEAN community is built on three pillars, not just one. Economic Community or AEC is just one of the three. And when we build the community, we also have another plan, narrowing the development gap. You have been to Laos, you have been to Cambodia, Myanmar, you see how they differ from Thailand. Certainly they are far behind Singapore. Small economies, underdeveloped economy, they will not benefit from the economy. In the economic side, we are combining our 10 economies into one ASEAN market. But business in Laos, can they sell anything to ASEAN market? They sell only electric power to Thailand. Cambodia also produce very little that can be exported, except maybe the paddy. So we have to do something else to share the benefit with smaller member states. And that's why we have the cultural, social side. This social, cultural community will emphasize human security, human development issues. In the political side, very important that we keep on improving our political cooperation. If we do not do that, we have many problems left behind by history. Give you a good example, the Khao Phao Vihan temple. It's a problem left behind by history. Occasionally it flare up, we have border clashes a few years ago. And that's why we need to continue to improve our political cooperation. Economic reason for building the community is quite obvious. In this globalization world, small economy will be at a disadvantage. Big economy, big corporation, big company have the advantage of at least the size, at least the capital. They'll be able to compete better. And that's why ASEAN has to come together to form ASEAN market. Just look at the number of population. When we come together at ASEAN, 620 million and counting. And that is the advantage of size in the global market, because now we compete at the global market. The diversity in ASEAN, we are so different in many ways. We speak different languages. How to make them live together peacefully first, and then work together. Social community side, there is an area focusing on promoting public awareness of ASEAN, public understanding of ASEAN. And that's why it's very useful for you students to come here and learn a little bit about ASEAN, because you are the future generation that have to carry on community building in ASEAN. But first, you must know about ASEAN, and then further down the road, you understand, appreciate what ASEAN is doing. Further down, when you start working, you support ASEAN. I think that is the future. In the ASEAN Charter, we confirm that we use only English as the working language in ASEAN, which means in ASEAN meeting, we use only English, we don't do translation. And this actually saves us, ASEAN, a lot of money. In the European Union, they still need to use at least three working languages, English, French, and Spanish. And now they have 28 member states. They need to translate a lot of documents. Every European document will have to be translated. But when they are in a meeting, it's very difficult to find interpreter who can translate simultaneously. So they use a lot of money on interpretation and translation in European Union. In ASEAN, we are lucky. Our founding father agreed that better use a common language, English, so that there is no need to translate. Functionally. But ASEAN also follow decision making based on consultation and consensus. Consensus means every member state in ASEAN agrees. It's a good principle for decision making because it is based on equality. Big or small in ASEAN, everyone has a say, equal say in ASEAN. In ASEAN Charter, we will not tell member states what should be the political system criteria, political criteria for the membership in ASEAN. One big difference in European Union, a country wanting to join European Union must prove to be a functioning multi-party democracy with good record of human rights protection. But in ASEAN, every country in Southeast Asia can apply. The political leader in ASEAN, usually Indonesia, because it's the largest. Indonesia also has the most number of embassies around the world, more than 200. Beyond 2015, that's why I mentioned, we have to continue to improve our political cooperation. Whatever happens inside a country may have regional impact. And that's how we have to come together to share information, the way we share information, ask questions on Myanmar in the past. Well, in ASEAN, there is an ASEAN Intergovernmental Commission on Human Rights, AICHR. ASEAN is reviewing the term of reference of this ASEAN Human Rights Commission. They are quite active, but they are promoting, first of all, promoting understanding of human rights. And they are trying to move beyond promotion into protection. So that's the next move beyond 2015. ASEAN centrality basically means we are, or we want to be, the center of action, center of dialogue, cooperation in Southeast Asia. If you want international acceptance recognition, ASEAN must build a successful community, make ourselves successful, increase our economic weight, increase our political weight, increase our diplomatic weight. Connectivity, well, we have a master plan. It is the plan to connect ASEAN member state physically by building highway, linking highway, railroad also being linked, electric power line also being linked, gas pipeline being linked, being built. Institutionally, we also harmonizing, adapting our laws and regulation, government regulation, so that they are more similar. And the third part of it is people-to-people connectivity, tourism, exchange of student visit. That's what you are doing. Very important to promote connectivity. Common platform. By the year 2022, ASEAN leaders already have a commitment to create an ASEAN common platform on which member government will formulate or try to formulate common ASEAN position. That's very important. Otherwise, because of our diversity, we tend to have different position. That is not good for ASEAN in the long run. So in the future, by the year 2022, ASEAN will try to have common position on all major global issues. If we don't come together and show that we are one, we are united, we risk being torn apart by the major power. Because Southeast Asia is a very important strategic geographical location in this part of the world. So all the major powers claim to have strategic interest in Southeast Asia. That's why in Southeast Asia, ASEAN want to be in charge of our own affairs. ASEAN want to be in control. We don't want to be used by any external power. Culturally, we are also quite different. Buddhism in Laos, Cambodia, Myanmar, Thailand, but Islam, Brunei, Malaysia, Indonesia, Christianity, Catholic in Philippines. Political diversity, different political system. Diversity in terms of transparency. Only three countries in ASEAN passed the transparency test done by the Transparency International. Brunei, Malaysia, Singapore. All the other seven failed, including Thailand, failed miserably. Transparency is how a government is accountable to the people. Transparency or lack of transparency means there are problems with corruption. For example, business people will complain when they run into problems in government lack of transparency. Normally, national interest always comes first for every government. That is given, that is expected. But when a country becomes ASEAN chair, it has additional responsibility to also think about ASEAN common interest. China is one of the 10 ASEAN dialogue partners. China now is a very important trading partner of most countries in ASEAN. Democracy will work only when there is rule of law.
Many visitors to Singapore may think that the island state consists of only office towers and condominiums, but they would be very wrong. Located on the west bank of Singapore River lies a district that is known as Chinatown. And this area is one of the liveliest areas of Singapore. The original location of Chinatown was identified specifically by Sir Stamford Raffles, who insists that the area be divided along the line of class and province of origin. And as such, certain areas were identified as Hokkien, Teochew, or Cantonese when Chinatown first developed. Today, that division can still be seen, although less obviously so. Although the architecture of houses and shops is not of any one particular style, many of the buildings have been declared National Heritage Sites. The different streets and areas within Chinatown have undergone many changes over the years, but the one constant is the lively atmosphere of this area of the city, and one that should not be missed. Singapore is home to the original offices for Discovery Channel. As we have been traveling throughout the region and making our documentary, we want to see how the real professionals create their documentaries. We spent a few wonderful hours with a production team at Discovery and learned some of the tricks and secrets of documentary making.
How many years old Discovery Channel is?
30.
Not bad.
Wow.
1982 was when it was founded. It was first created by a man in the US, and John Hendricks at that time, he had a vision that he wanted to create a 24-hour documentary TV channel, and his kind of mission was, he felt that he wanted to go out and satisfy curiosity. Since then, Discovery has, I mean, it's enormous now. So Discovery Channel was the initial, the very first channel that was on the TV was that, Discovery. And then after the years, more and more channels then got added. So yeah, ever since 1982, when that one man had that vision, it's now, you know, blossomed into probably, what, 30, 40 channels?
So when someone has a great idea that's never been done before, we work out how you would do that. How are we going to do that? And there's not always a right or wrong answer. If it hasn't been done before, you're working it out. You work together and you go, how would we do that? So that's what you do. And that's really what production and what making programs is about. That's what's exciting. And for the young, as the guys were saying, for those who want to head into it, keep making, keep playing with your ideas and different ways of showing your ideas. Make things with your friends. Keep playing. There's different ways of seeing it, and there are different ways of expressing that idea. And it's you communicating with people. It's all about communication. And then you put the practical behind that. And not everything that you're seeing now has been done before. And the same thing, things will evolve. There'll be new ideas, and you guys might be the ones who think of it. And if that's the case, and I look forward to working with you in a few years' time.
Yeah.
Is there any criteria on choosing your host?
It depends a lot on different factors. Do you mean a host as in someone you see on the camera, or just a voice?
On a camera.
On the camera. So, yeah, it would really depend upon, first of all, which market we want the film to be seen by. So if we were going to do, let's say, a travel series around Thailand, we need to make sure that it feels quite Thai, but it also feels very international as well. So what we often do is we often work with, you know, hosts which are maybe half Thai, or they've lived in Thailand, or they have some connection to Thailand, but they also have a relevance outside Thailand as well. So if you're an audience and you're watching, maybe if you're in Thailand, you can kind of identify with them. But if you're watching in Australia, you can also begin to identify with them as well, because they could be half American or half Australian.
So a lot of our personalities tend to be doing what they do anyway, and TV it just happens to be an extension of their personality and their expertise. So a good example is Jeremy Wade, when he came to Singapore, and of course we did press interviews. We had journalists asking Jeremy, going, what would you do if you were not on TV? And Jeremy's answer was, I'll still be doing this, just not on TV. Yeah. I'll still be fishing, looking for real monsters.
Just imagine after weeks of filming, and you go out to different parts of the world, and you know, you're always worried about, will the team bring back what you want? You know, are they going to come back and say, my gosh, we couldn't get anything? Of course not, but you do often worry about that. But when you finally see the material that they've shot, and they then begin to edit it together, and then the show comes to life, it's fantastic. You know, it feels like everyone's really pulled together, and all the efforts of everybody involved have now come to the screen, and it just feels wonderful. It's great.
On the east bank of Singapore River lies another lively and colourful district of Singapore, namely Little India. This area, unlike Chinatown, was not pre-planned by Sir Stamford, and as such, it developed in more organic manner. Regardless, Little India is lively and colourful district that offers much to see, do and taste. Spice grinders still ply their trade, grinding the spices needed for the Tamil cuisine and filling the air with a rich bouquet of exotic aromas. Those visitors who arrive in Singapore during Diwali, the Hindu festival of lights, celebrate near the end of the year. Little India is a must-see, as the area is lit up brilliantly and the celebratory atmosphere is palpable.
My favorite thing in Singapore is Discovery Channel.
Discovery Channel.
Discovery Channel.
Because I have learned many things, and for myself, I really love the Discovery Channel.
ISEAS.
ISEAS.
Because they give the many information about ASEAN.